friends. How are you? Welcome back to my channel for a money video. It's been a while since I've talked personal finance or just money in general, and y'all know it's one of my favorite topics to talk about because it is so important, and for some reason it's taboo, but it affects every aspect of our life. And I think learning from each other and talking about personal finance and income and managing our money well is a quick way to learning how to do the most with what we have and better our lives. So today I have another kind of just broad what nobody told me about money kind of video, where the past few months, whenever I've kind of had an epiphany or an aha moment or figured something out, I was like, why did nobody tell me about this? And I would write it down on my notes app. So I'm gonna share those things with you today. And I went ahead and structured this video where I'm gonna start off at the most kind of conceptual, broad, basic kind of aha moments. And then as this video goes on, I will get a little bit more like niche and in depth with maybe certain tax things that I'm just now learning and things that might be mostly applicable if you're self-employed. So hopefully this video will be most broad early on and then niche down the longer you go. So watch this until it feels no longer applicable and feel free to click out whenever. But I love you, and without further ado, this is what I've recently learned that nobody told me about money. This first thing hopefully is helpful if you are in kind of my age range or younger, is the power of time. I really did not realize how much time is on our side and how a little step actually makes a huge difference with the power of time. And I took a screenshot of this one example. I learned this recently when I was looking through our retirement accounts with our financial advisor. And we were looking at, if I pull this out when I'm 50, this is how much money I have. If I pull this out when I'm 55, whoa, it's double. If I pull this out when I'm 60, whoa, it's triple. And I went ahead and took a screenshot of this just so you can kind of visualize it. It says, data doesn't lie. Michael saved $1,000 a month from the time he turned 25 until he turned 35. Then he stopped saving his money, but left his money in his investment account where it continued to accrue a 7% rate until he retired at age 65. Okay? Jennifer held off and didn't start saving until age 35, but she put away $1,000 a month from her 35th birthday to her 45th birthday. Like Michael, she left the balance in her investment account where it continued to accrue 7% until the age of 65. And then Sam didn't get around to investing until age 45. He still invested $1,000 a month for 10 years, halting his savings by age 55. He then left his money and to accrue at a 7% rate until his 65th birthday. So Michael, Jennifer, and Sam each saved the same amount, $120,000 over a 10-year period, but their balances were dramatically different. So Sam, who saved from age 45 to 55, had $373,000 by the time he retired. Jennifer, who saved from age 35 to 45, had $734,000 by the time she retired. But Michael, who saved from age 25 to 35, had $1.44 million by the time he retired. So that is really motivating to me to know, okay, if I just put a little bit aside now, it's gonna be so much later than if I put a lot aside later, if you know what I mean. So that's really motivated me to set aside money now to show love to my future self. Something else kind of broad in general is it's way easier to set aside money at the beginning of the month than the end of the month. You kind of let yourself spend what you have. So if you don't even give yourself the option to spend a certain amount of money at the beginning of the month, you will save it. So I've started paying myself out at the beginning of the month instead of just setting aside whatever I have left over at the end of the month. And it's kept me accountable. And it's, I have been putting away 5 times more than I was when I was just waiting until the end of the month. And that's something that no one really told me, but is hugely helpful. This is also kind of broad in general, but nobody told me that banks that don't have brick and mortar locations are so much more beneficial. In my opinion, factually, they pay you more. They have much higher APYs. I was banking at Wells Fargo because that's where my family banked. And I set up an account there when I was, I don't know, 15, 16, because that's where my family was. And they were making 0.01% APY on my savings accounts. I switched over to a bank, Ally, which at the time, their savings were making 1.6% APY. So literally 160 times more a year in APY than I was at Wells Fargo. There's another bank I really wanna look into. I don't bank with them yet, but Empower. And I've heard great things about them because they have high APY for checking accounts, which is pretty rare. And I know what you might be thinking, well, what if I need to pull out money or deposit money or whatever that might be? A lot of banks like Empower, which I wanna look into, they actually waive a certain number of ATM fees every single month. for free. So it's like having a bank as an ATM for free. Something else nobody told me is just make sure that they're FDIC insured. Normally it's up to like $250,000. And that means if the bank goes under, if you have $250,000 or less in that bank, you will get it back. So obviously it's risky to have more than that in a bank. But that's why I'm looking into another bank that doesn't have brick and mortar, because I'm so over Wells Fargo and US Bank and all those, because they kind of just suck, if I'm being honest. Something else that I didn't know until this year, I talked about this in a vlog, is if you're self-employed, it is important to keep track of not what you earned in a year, but what you were paid in a year. So for example, I know exactly what I earned in 2020. I know how much brands owe me, how much affiliate links owe me, how much all this owes me, but some brands are net 30, net 60, net 90. I even have some affiliate links that are literally net 145. So I don't get paid for a half a year later. What I get paid according to my accountant in each year is how much I'm taxed. So I was like, okay, this is how much I made in this year. This is probably how much I'll be taxed. But no, I need to figure out how much I was paid in this year, because that's how much I'll be taxed. And even though I made money in 2020, I will be taxed on it in 2021 because it doesn't hit my account until 2021. So that's something that nobody told me and that I need to keep track of. Now, we're getting into the little more niche things. This is something that nobody told me and it really makes my blood boil. I mean, I know why we have taxes. I get it. I feel like people that are trying to make opportunities for themselves are penalized and punished a little bit. And if you didn't know this, I didn't know this. If you're self-employed, you have an additional tax. In 2020, the self-employed tax was 15.3% net earnings. On top of all your other normal federal income tax, state income tax if you're in California, because California really likes to make me sad. I miss Texas, I miss not having state income tax. But that's something nobody told me to account for, is if you have any money that is not coming from an employer, you need to make sure to set aside 15.3% of all net profits as self-employed tax. But I learned something a little bit later that will help with self-employed tax. I'll get to that in just a minute. But I wanna first talk about retirement accounts. So I set up a Roth IRA, and that is essentially a retirement account that you can put $6,000 a year into per person. That's the maximum you could put into. So if you break that up monthly, that's $500 a month per person, or for Brooke and I, our household, that's $1,000 a month per household for us as a couple. And so that's what we do. We max that out, which is great. A Roth IRA is post-tax. So that money has already been taxed, right? So I'm putting that money into this account. And whenever I hit the age limit to where I can access this money without any sort of penalties or fees, that money was already taxed in 2018 and 2019 and 2020 when I put it in. So that money is my money, which is amazing. But there's something else called a SEP IRA, and I just opened one of these accounts. A SEP IRA is a little bit different. You can put way more money into it. So as of right now, you could put $57,000 a year into it maximum, but this is pre-taxed. So this is beneficial in very different ways. So I can look and say, okay, this is pre-tax. So if I put this money into an account right now, maybe this money would have already been taxed. So I actually have to pay less taxes now, which is great. But whenever I pull this money out later, I have to pay tax on what was earned from this money. So it's kind of a game of, do I want to pay less taxes now and let that money grow but pay taxes later? And I'm realizing, yeah. Because I would want to earn the money, the interest on the dollars that I would otherwise just give away to the government now. I'm gonna earn that interest over the next 40 years and I'll still pay them their share later, but it's basically free money. So I'm gonna be maxing out my Roth IRA and then setting aside however much money makes sense into my SEP IRA to help alleviate taxes for myself right now, hopefully earn some money on the taxes I would already be paying, and then pay those taxes later whenever I access those funds when I'm ready to retire. You can also, this is something that I did not know about retirement accounts necessarily, but you can access them whenever you want. It's just if you access them younger, you pay fees. You pay kind of like penalties, or you can access them after a certain age. I forget what the age is because it's so far in my future. I'll look it up and I'll put text right here. But if you access it after that point, then you don't have to pay those fees. But this is something very interesting that I literally learned this week. Back to self-employed tax. I've reached the point in my business where I should become incorporated, which is super interesting. I never thought about it this way, but my accountant said I should become an S-Corp. And the benefit to doing this is mostly just avoiding some of the self-employed income tax. When you become incorporated, so me, Jancy Media, or Jancy Incorporated, or Mikkel Jancy Media, I haven't decided my name for it yet. I'm trying to decide what sounds coolest. Brooke thinks I should make Jancy Media and then have Jancy the label, because that sounds kind of cool. But Jancy Media would pay Mikkel Jancy Smith, the employee, a salary. So I might be my only actual salaried employee, but what you do is you pay yourself a reasonable salary. So right now I really only pay myself $3,500 a month and I don't touch the rest. And so I would be taxed, self-employed tax, on the $3,500 a month, but I would not be taxed on the rest of it. I could still access the rest of it as a distribution, but I wouldn't be taxed on it. Now, people kind of become an S-Corp and cheat the system saying, oh, my reasonable salary is $500 a month. The IRS really looks at S-Corps because they know it can kind of be easily manipulated. So it's important that people that become incorporated actually allow themselves a reasonable salary, something that they could actually live off of to be subject to the self-employed tax. And after that point, it's great because literally maybe half of my money won't be subject to self-employed tax, which is amazing, or more. So that's something I had no idea was even possible, but is something that is great to consider. Obviously, there's a lot of legal fees associated with it. You have to have annual filing fees, and there's a lot more regulations, and it's a big headache. And so a lot of times people decide, you know what, I'll just pay those taxes because it's not worth the time, effort, energy to turn into an S-Corp. But eventually, once you start making a certain amount of money, the money you save will definitely be worth the time, energy, and legalities associated with incorporating. So that's something I learned just this week. This was kind of a short little video of me compiling the things I didn't know. A very long time ago, I made a video talking about a lot of basics that nobody told me about money. Keep in mind, this was a long time ago. I had very different equipment, so the quality of the video is not great, but the information in the video is still good. Talking about credit cards and credit score and saving accounts and all that kind of stuff. So I will link that old video down below if you want just a very like elementary beginners, what nobody told me about money. And this one is more conceptual and self-employed, what nobody told me about money, but I hope you enjoyed. Let me know if you did, and I would love to make this a series. Comment down below anything that you recently learned about money, because I want to learn from you and we can all learn from each other, because it's so important and it's so confusing. And where are we supposed to learn these things? I didn't learn them in school. Did you learn them in school? I know the Y equals MX plus B, but I don't know how to pay my taxes. Woohoo! Jokes aside, I love learning with you guys. Thank you for watching, and thank you for allowing this to be a safe space where we can talk about things that others might consider to be taboo as we all try to become the best versions of ourselves and be the wisest with our money possible. I hope you have the best rest of your day, and I will see you in a video very soon. Bye. All that we have.